Appendix 2 on Counseling Abductees and Contactees, an Introduction. In this short appendix, I will present some of the basic treatment considerations that I found helpful in working with UFO abductees and contactees. Although these two groups are quite different, there are common dynamics that require particular clinical approaches. First of all, these two terms are currently used in a variety of ways, and they need to be defined clearly. Essentially, they can be defined on the basis of the quality of the interaction and the intentions of the initiating agent. Those for whom I am using the term abductee are people who have experienced emotional trauma and violation and feel that their contact was of a harmful nature. On the other hand, those for whom the more neutral term contactee seems to apply have experienced inspiration and joy from their contact and often feel a buoyant spiritual transformation. If we acknowledge that indeed there are both benevolent and non-benevolent ET groups, those we can call positive and negative, then using different terms for contact with the two different groups makes good sense. Frankly, I disagree with the opinions of many of my colleagues in the field. I disagree with researchers who say we cannot understand ET motivations, and with clinicians who consider a contact experience of fear and trauma to be merely the product of human ignorance. And I also disagree with leading UFO experts who believe that all ET races are either loving or evil. If you have read the first two sections of this book, you already know my perspective on ET groups and their intentions. In particular, look at the chapters in Section 1 entitled Inside the Confederation and ETs and the Law of Free Will. It should be remembered, the notion of genuine cosmic polarity, or what could be called good and evil, or left-hand and right-hand paths, is fully supported by all mystic traditions, including Buddhism, Hinduism, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and Gnosticism. Also remember, the belief systems held by therapists, healers, or counselors will inevitably influence all aspects of treatment and therapeutic rapport, and so we need to acknowledge and understand our own personal, metaphysical assumptions before beginning the work. Our beliefs may obstruct and neutralize, or instead invigorate and support the efficiency of the self-healing process. Nevertheless, regardless of these intellectual parameters, there are key concepts which guide all therapeutic intervention, and successful healing does not depend on intellectual agreement between therapist and client. True healing results from the provision of care, emotional support, cognitive clarification, and a strengthening of the client's personal will, self-acceptance, and spiritual centering. True healing occurs in a loving therapeutic relationship. Before presenting these treatment considerations, I must also make one essential caveat regarding the healer's definition of his or her role and purpose in this work. Borrowing from modern medicine, many therapists consider it their duty to fix and correct those with whom they work, an often irresistible tendency with experiencers of anomalous trauma. However, this mechanistic, objectifying attitude is perhaps nowhere more potentially destructive than with contactees and abductees. With all due humility, let me issue a command. If you feel it to be your professional obligation to return clients back to a conventional view of reality, you really should not be working in this field. Intellectual debate over the supposed reality or objectivity of anomalous experiences can intensify the perceived or felt abuse, especially with contactees and those who've had negative contact. And this can actually destroy the healing process. The clinical setting is not the proper place for debate or argument over metaphysical theory. However, as I said before, our conceptual assumptions must be clarified before we embark upon the work with others. The essential treatment dynamics I will present can be classified according to their primary level of influence. It hardly needs mentioning that the individual experience of ET contact affects every aspect of personal life, from the most subjective self-understanding to the most universal questioning of one's place in the cosmos. Therefore, all levels of human experience must be honored in the work. Some key considerations, although not an exhaustive list, follow below. The physical level. Many clients, especially abductees, will present physical ailments associated with their experience. Unless requested, their objective reality should not be challenged. Whether their origin is psychosomatic or a result of genuine interdimensional contact, proper medical care, including allopathic and or alternative medicine, ought to be given. If you consider these afflictions to be purely psychological, this will likely damage trust and rapport, which are essential preconditions required to process any and all psychological trauma between the healer and client. With those who have experienced violation-type contact, the specific nature of physical and or interdimensional or energy-based wounding may generate and correlate with particular emotional dynamics. Pre-existing psychological conflicts regarding body image will be stimulated and exacerbated, including those that are gender-specific, e.g. fertility, potency, and otherwise, attractiveness, health, strength, fragility, protection, vulnerability, and physical integrity. These issues will then be mirrored at the cognitive level, often generating what can be called self-defeating self-talk, such as, now I am ugly and no one will love me, now I am slowly falling apart. Counselors need to understand this linkage between physical symptoms and mental emotional processing. The emotional level. Intensification of particular emotional reactions is common to both contactees and abductees. Feelings of fear, despair, or self-pity, as well as joy, grace, or bliss, may be uncontrollable. This can be understood as a normal and natural response to profound interdimensional events, which will inevitably affect our core beliefs, body image, social integrity, self-integrity, social adjustment, intellectual and/or spiritual worldview. A period of emotional upheaval is inevitable, and the person will need a lot of patience and self-acceptance along the way of gradual emotional readjustment. A pattern of persistent emotional disorientation that baffles the process of emotional healing and integration is equally common. UFO abductees often experience self-estrangement in many forms. Depression with dulled sensitivity, vague foreboding and doom, dissociation from the feeling life, and or disorganized panic, which may be chronic or situational. Contactees, whose experience is generally more positive, may go through feelings of messianic mission, severe self-criticism often accompanied by exaggeration of perceived spiritual imperfection, and long-term discouragement related to seeing ever more clearly their own unachieved potentials. Healers need to help anchor self-acceptance, reasonable definition, and greater integration to all such potent emotions. The mental level. The intensity of intellectual shock will depend on prior personality tendencies and the nature of the ET contact. People who are not particularly intellectually based may experience no trauma at all, no sense of a shattered worldview, but instead a new vista of comprehension. For the highly analytical, whose self-esteem has been based upon their cohesive understanding of, quote, the way things are, UFO contact can be utterly devastating, leading to long-term confusion, conceptual disorientation, and critical self-blame. With contacts that involve significant transfer of spiritual or technical information, a profusion of new ideas that demand integration is common. Cognitive-based counseling must recognize both the client's personality type and the ET contact dynamics. Many clients also experience a spiritualization of life interests. This may show a newfound fascination with New Age subjects, religion, or studies of the paranormal. As far as possible, any material gained on these forays, which the person deems important, can be brought into the counseling dialogue and the healing process. Properly integrated and appreciated, they can shed light upon the person's deeper issues and provide direction for the future. Efforts should also be made to stay true to the person's own experience without mixing in borrowed concepts that seem glamorous or sensational, but end up taking the person away from their own process. Meditation, in particular, can be a valuable tool to assist emotional balancing, self-acceptance, and the resolution of intellectual quandaries. Ideally, counselors should also have a background in metaphysics. The social level. As can be expected, the social ramifications of ET contact or a perceived abduction violation can be severe. The entire network of a person's friends, associates, and family can heap scorn and ridicule upon them, leading to isolation, self-doubt, and undermining the fragile healing process. Sympathetic social support is essential so that people are not left alone with panic or disorientation. It may be necessary to cut adrift those social contacts that are actively destructive. Abductees, in particular, usually cannot navigate the post-traumatic integration process alone. An extreme need for support is usually indicative of negative ET contact, which tend to violate central aspects of self-alignment. As an element of the cognitive dissonance generally following UFO-ET contact, a person's perceptions of human society may also be radically altered. Clients may become bitter or cynical upon feeling socially exiled, then cut themselves off from society in response. In cases of transformative, uplifting ET contact, inflated desires to save the world may lead to zealous dogmatism and also result in personal isolation. Counselors ought to encourage appropriate, congruent, and self-chosen social reintegration and possibly also a period of active, soul-searching solitude. Maintaining emotional balance is essential to those who are returning to ordinary society following all such anomalous experiences. The spiritual level. For many, UFO contact of any sort is seen as a profound opportunity for self-development and expanded awareness of the universal order. However, for abductees, the traumatic consequences demand immediate attention and should never be glossed over in an attempt to look at the bright side. Only after the healing process of personality reintegration gains momentum can the spiritual dimensions be fully addressed. Considerations of meaning and value will vary for each client. As a primary therapeutic intervention, spiritually minded healers may support abductees in, quote, breaking agreements, presumably made at subconscious levels with hostile aliens. Combined with careful cultivation of the client's sense of divine will and protection, this technique may offer one of the best long-term solutions for those who wish to terminate ongoing traumatic ET contact. However, therapists should have significant training in the theory and practice of such intervention before making any attempts in this direction, since misguided efforts can do much more harm than good. Additionally, I've had very good results teaching clients traditional Buddhist mantras for protection and soul illumination. When these practices are done with power and sincerity, they really do work. One of the best is the traditional Tibetan Vajrayana chant, Om Mani Padme Hum, which is pronounced Om Mani Padme Hum. This is a form of white magic, and again, counselors without background in these matters may want to get some further training. In conclusion, as benevolent ET contact and traumatic UFO abduction affects all levels of the individual's experience, so must our treatment considerations address the multi-layered consequences of such extreme, anomalous experience. Counselors must remain sympathetic and supportive despite any assertions and claims made by the experiencer that may be considered outrageous or unbelievable. As the primary healing does not emanate from the intellectual level, all debate over objectivity is generally inappropriate in the counseling, although as it proceeds, the mental level must also be addressed, as well as the client's metaphysical education through focused self-study. In general, the basic work of self-empowerment, emotional catharsis, cognitive reordering, and social readjustment are essential to dealing with any personal crisis, especially in the beginning stages. Ultimately, however, the spiritual dimensions of the ET contact and abduction also have to be addressed, including the need for a balanced, expanded view of the universe and human potential, as well as an understanding of the cosmic plan and the tools available for accelerated personal growth, including formal meditation practice.